Good morning, everybody. Good morning and welcome. My name is Tom Banchoff. I'm Vice President for Global Engagement here at Georgetown and Director of our Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs. And on behalf of the university and the center, I'm delighted to welcome you to today's conference on international religious freedom toward a model of transatlantic cooperation. In a moment, you'll hear from my colleague Tom Farr, Director of our Religious Freedom Project here at Georgetown, about the genesis and purpose of this important conference and about all the partners we brought together today around these critical issues. As most of you know, I think, since its inception more than 4 years ago, the RFP, as we call it, has become a leading university-based effort to explore and debate the importance and the implications of religious liberty historically and for our contemporary era. We do so through research, teaching, publications, and events like this, which are part of the Berkley Center's wider efforts to explore intersections between religion, peace, and world affairs. Now, our topic today, religious liberty, also resonates powerfully with Georgetown University's history and identity. As the oldest Catholic and Jesuit university in the United States, founded in 1789, an institution open to other religious traditions from its origins, Georgetown's identity and mission are powerfully bound up with the principle and with the exercise of religious freedom. In this context, one of our university-wide initiatives, the Global Futures Initiative, which brings together our strengths across disciplines around global issues, is serving as one of the co-sponsors of our conference today. Now, as a glance at any newspaper will tell you, the issue of religious freedom, of religious liberty, is as important, as contested today, as perhaps it has ever been, certainly in our lifetimes. The extent of religious persecution around the world and the threat it poses across traditions has made it a global issue, a truly global issue, global in its extent, but also in its visibility in an unprecedented way. And of course, global issues to be addressed effectively, and that is one of the focuses of our conference. How do we move from a discussion and analysis of the problem to action? To be addressed effectively have to be addressed in today's world at the global level, and that means they have to be addressed at the transatlantic level as well, given the critical role of the United States and Europe in our emerging global order. So that's the stage, that's the setting for our conference today. We've got an excellent program you'll hear about more in a moment. I just want to personally recognize Peter Berger, who will be kicking off our conference, our extended conversation with a keynote. I can't imagine anyone better qualified to provide the big picture for us as we get started. In closing, I'd like to acknowledge the John Templeton Foundation for its longstanding and generous support of the RFP, and thank our lead partners on this event, the British Council, Baylor University's Institute for Studies of Religion, and the University of Notre Dame Center for Civil and Human Rights. Thank you all for coming. Like you, I look forward to a great exchange over the course of the day. And now I'd ask you to please join me in welcoming my colleague Tom Farr, Director of the Religious Freedom Project, to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. And thanks for your leadership here at Georgetown University. On behalf of the Religious Freedom Project, welcome to the campus of Georgetown University on this beautiful fall morning for what I can promise you is going to be an intellectually stimulating and probably occasionally entertaining day as well. As Tom mentioned, and as Dan Philpott is going to elaborate in just a moment, we have a terrific lineup of co-sponsors, many of whose banners you will see up here. The stage wasn't quite large enough for all of them. I'd just like to add my personal thanks, as Tom did, to a number of people, Fabio Petizio and the British Council, Dennis Hoover and the Institute for Global Engagement, and the Review of Faith and International Affairs, of which Dennis is the editor, my old friend and colleague Cole Durham, who's out there somewhere, and his International Center for Law and Religion Studies at the Brigham Young University, Walter Mead, and, of course, the great Peter Berger and the Institute on Culture, Religion, and World Affairs at Boston University, directed by Robert Hefner. I'm grateful to all of you and our other co-sponsors as well. Let me say a word about the Religious Freedom Project here at Georgetown and the significance of this event today for our activities. The RFP represents a strategic partnership between Georgetown University and Baylor University's Institute for Studies of Religion under its director, Professor Byron Johnson, who I believe I saw here earlier today. I'm sure he's here somewhere. I'm delighted that you're here, Byron, and I'm particularly delighted to welcome the president and chancellor of Baylor University, Judge Ken Starr, who is here with us today. Thank you, Judge, for coming. We have three basic premises. Always start with three, especially if you're a Trinitarian like I am. We have three basic premises at the Religious Freedom Project. First, religious freedom is important for individuals and for societies for a whole host of reasons, many of which we will talk about today, and these are not uncontested propositions, but I want to tell you what we think. For example, we believe human beings are, by their nature, truth seekers. By their nature, they want to know the answers to the questions about the source of their being, the order of reality, why they're here, is there something after death? No one can be said to be living a fully human life if they are not free to pursue those questions and to order their lives in accord with the answers that they discover. But religious freedom has social consequences as well. It's not just important to individuals. It's highly correlated, religious freedom is, with other social, economic, political goods, such as economic growth and development, the consolidation and stability of democracy, the undermining of religious violence and religion-related terrorism. Second premise, notwithstanding its importance, religious freedom is in global crisis. Outside the West, the symptoms too often include violent, brutal persecution of religious minorities. Inside the West, including in the United States, the symptoms include increasing government restrictions on religion and rising social hostility to religion, particularly religious actors in the public square. Third proposition, these problems are not getting sufficient attention, in our view, from opinion shapers and policymakers. Our goal at the Religious Freedom Project, as Tom Banchoff has said, is to raise the profile of this issue, to build knowledge and awareness about religious freedom, its value, and give a fair hearing to people with really differing views, and you're going to hear some of that today, too. So today's conference, for us, is the kickoff of a year-long examination of U.S. international religious freedom policy, America's policy of advancing religious freedom. For 17 years and over three administrations of both parties, the United States has been required by law to advance religious freedom in its foreign policy. Is this policy a wise one? Is U.S. policy helping the victims of religious freedom around the world? Is it advancing American interests? What, if anything, could we be doing better? In 2008, Dennis Hoover and I published a little book entitled The Future of U.S. International Religious Freedom Policy Recommendations for the Obama Administration. That was at the beginning of what became two consecutive administrations. We're going to re-examine the premises of that book during the course of this year, beginning today. And then in early 2017, we will reissue the book to the new administration and the new president. Wonder who that will be. What better way to begin this journey, though, than our conference today, International Religious Freedom Toward a Model of Transatlantic Cooperation? Can the Western democracies agree in principle to advance religious freedom? If so, can they cooperate in the breach? What are the stakes? What are the obstacles? So let's get to it. We have a wonderful lineup of speakers, which you can see in your programs. Let me turn you over to Professor Dan Philpott, Director of the Center for Civil and Human Rights at Notre Dame University, and I'm proud to say also one of the scholars of the Religious Freedom Project. Dan, over to you. Please welcome Dan Philpott.
Thank you, Tom and Tom. Ladies and gentlemen, it is also my pleasure to welcome you to this policy dialogue, International Religious Freedom Towards a Model of Transatlantic Cooperation. Again, I'm Dan Philpott and Director of the Center for Civil and Human Rights at the University of Notre Dame. 17 years ago, in 1998, the U.S. Congress mandated religious freedom in U.S. foreign policy through the International Religious Freedom Act. In recent years, Canada, Britain, Austria, Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, Norway, and the European Union have adopted foreign policies of religious freedom in one way or another. Might these democracies cooperate in promoting religious freedom around the world? The promise of such a proposal is that through multilateral cooperation, the promotion of religious freedom would be empowered. The proposal, though, is not without its difficulties. Would multilateral cooperation water down the pursuit of religious freedom so as to make it meaningless? Would there be fractiousness over strategy or all talk and little action? Would the comparatively secular character of European societies inhibit cooperation with the United States? What about Western Europe's comparatively strong tendency to govern religion through the state? Western European and the United States also have different experiences with Muslim populations. Will this affect their ability to cooperate on religious freedom? Even if a cooperative approach to religious freedom were to be developed, how would it play outside the West? Would it foment cultural clash? Or could the consensus on religious freedom be widened? These are the kinds of questions that we will be exploring over the next 2 days. The coalition of sponsors behind the event is itself a remarkable feat of transatlantic multilateral cooperation. The coalition is a confluence of two streams. The series run by Georgetown's Religious Freedom Project and its related partners, whom we are pleased to welcome, Peter Berger and Boston University, Baylor University, the Institute of Global Engagement, is one of these streams that Tom Farr just described. The other stream began with a Building Bridges grant from the British Council for a series of two policy dialogues on religious freedom across the Atlantic. The architect of these dialogues is Professor Fabio Petito of Sussex University, sitting right here in the front row. And I want to acknowledge Fabio as more than anyone else. It's he whose brainchild these policy dialogues were, the second one of which is today. He was kind enough to approach me and the Center for Civil and Human Rights at Notre Dame to form a partnership. The first of these dialogues took place at Wilton Park Conference Center in England back in February. This event is the second of the two. As a dialogue, this event is designed as a mutual and vigorous conversation conducted in the hopes of developing cooperation. Fabio also forged relationships with other partners who were indispensable for this dialogue. One is the International Center for Law and Religion Studies at Brigham Young University, directed by Cole Durham, who's here, himself one of the great forces for religious freedom in the world. Cole's center contributed to this event quite significantly, both in resources and by bringing some 40 speakers and other participants. McGill University's Burks Forum on the World Religions contributed their resources and their ideas to today's events, and we welcome both Anne Leahy and Daniel Sear, both of whom bring to us their distinguished scholarly and diplomatic records in religion and politics. And we regret the late cancellation of Professor Armando Salvatore, who also contributed significantly from McGill. Finally, the European University Institute and the University of Milan teamed up on the Dialogues Project, and we are grateful for those here representing these fine institutions. Got all that? Now for the coming attraction. We are honored to have Professor Peter Berger as our keynote speaker and Professor Walter Russell Mead responding to him. Professor Mead will introduce Peter Berger. Until late yesterday, we had David Brooks of the New York Times also responding to Peter Berger. We got an email from David last night saying that he was 1,500 miles away from Washington, D.C., and had two flights canceled and utterly beyond his control, was not able to make it. He is deeply regretful, completely beyond his control, and we wish him safe travels back to Washington. But at the last minute, we have a wonderful agreement from Oz Guinness, who just walked in the door, to also serve as a respondent to Professor Berger. Oz Guinness. And maybe the first thing that comes to mind is that anything like Guinness beer? Well, it turns out the answer is yes. He's the great-grandson of the founder of Guinness beer, which I think is his most distinguished accomplishment. He's also the author of 30 books about Christianity and religion and politics. One of his most central driving questions is, how do we live with one another despite our religious differences? How do we develop a healthy pluralism? And he's founder of the Trinity Forum, which has been devoted to these questions, author of 30 books, and also a pioneer of what is known as the Williamsburg Charter on Religious Freedom. So I wish now to say how honored we are to have Professor Walter Russell Mead with us, who is one of America's great public intellectuals, especially in foreign relations. He is the James Clark Chase Professor of Foreign Affairs and Humanities at Bard College and Editor-at-Large and Online Director of American Interest. From 1997 to 2010, he was the Henry A. Kissinger Senior Fellow for U.S. Foreign Policy at the Council on Foreign Relations. He is the author of the influential Special Providence, American Foreign Policy and How It Changed the World, and God and Gold, Britain, America, and the Making of the Modern World, a major study of 400 years of conflict between Anglophone powers and their rivals. Walter writes regularly on international affairs for leading newspapers and magazines. If you don't know of him, chances are you really haven't been reading. Please join me in welcoming Walter Russell Mead in our opening panel.
Great. Well, it is really wonderful to be here. It's an honor to be asked to participate in an event of this kind, and it's a special honor and pleasure to sit on a panel with Peter Berger. Although I have to say, if you sit on a panel with Peter Berger, you need to be ready you need to just give up. Because Peter will have the best jokes. He will have the greatest range of knowledge about the way the world works. He will have a scholarly reputation which you in a dozen lifetimes could never hope to match. And just as one of the great human beings in this world of sometimes difficult world of scholarship, Peter remains, I think, someone that all of us are privileged to know, and many of us hope at least a little bit to be able to emulate. So, Peter, thank you so much for being here on the panel. And Oz Guinness, who again I'm sure is well known to many people here, some of whom know his great-grandfather's work better than they know his work. But I'm thinking of a couple of research associates who work with me, of whom that might be said. And they live to deepen their knowledge of his work. But Oz is, again, over many years, has developed a reputation as one of the sharpest thinkers, most honest contributors, and as someone whose work in organizing institutions and helping them flourish has done as much to build the civil society conversation about religion in our time as perhaps anyone in the world. So it's you've got some wonderful people here. I am not going to take up too much time here because I think we're all waiting to hear from Peter. After Peter has finished his remarks, I'll ask Oz to make a response. Then if there's anything at all left to say after that, I'll try to shape up the state of the conversation and maybe ask the two of them to engage a little bit, at which point we will throw it open to the floor for questions. But thank you all for coming, and I think we are looking forward to really a wonderful experience. Peter?
Well, I think I should begin by letting you into two secrets. One is that Walter and I have, I guess, what teenage boys call the pissing context, and who can tell more jokes about a particular topic? And I think it was in Washington a couple of years ago that he and I competed for about 40 minutes, if my memory is correct, all about Romanian jokes, which maybe we should drop everything and do that instead of talking about the topic issue. The other thing, my grandmother told me never to begin any address with an apology, but looking around, I think I owe you an apology why I'm not wearing a tie. And the reason is I'm uncomfortable enough traveling around in a wheelchair because of very bad arthritis, and I may as well be comfortable farther up. And the secret I should let you in, I'm now work as a consultant for the Greek government, which I think legitimizes that uniform. What I intend to do in these remarks is to place the issue of religious freedom, which happens to be an issue in which I believe very fervently, in a larger context of religious landscape today. And any interpretation of the world, I think, begins with trying to shoot out of the water other interpretations of the world. And that's very much the case here. When I began my work in sociology of religion, which, as some of you know, was about the time of Lincoln's second inaugural, I believed in what everyone else believed, which came to be known as secularization theory, which has some very sophisticated expressions, but which basically has a very basic thesis. The more modernity, less religion. We live in an age of religious decline. It took me about 25 years to conclude that this was a mistake. We don't live in a pluralist, in a secular age. We live in a pluralistic age. And that does create specific challenges for every religious faith and every religious tradition, but it's a different challenge from that of secularity. For the last few years, I and some other colleagues began with a very interesting conference in Germany. Actually, it was a very interesting conference. It was at the University of Münster, where a professor by the name of Detlef Pollack runs a program on religion and modernity. And he's been one of the staunch defenders of secularization theory, one of the decreasing number of people who still stick to secularization theory. And I have criticized that. I veered away from it. And we agreed on a lot of issues. And one of the things I'm going to mention is pluralism needs formulas of peace. And one of the most important, where people manage to live together without killing each other, one of the important ones in Western history was the Peace of Westphalia, which ended the horrible religious wars in Europe between Catholics and Protestants. And we ended up saying we are doing a Westphalian peace between secularization theorists and their critics. And we've kept this up. It's a very useful relationship. Now, basic presupposition, not presupposition, but basic basis of whatever I have to say about the religious landscape and its implications for religious freedom comes from that simple statement. We don't live in a secular age. We live in a pluralistic age. I changed my mind about this, let me emphasize, not because of any religious or philosophical changes on my part. Throughout my adult life, I've been a moderate but incurable Lutheran. So it wasn't some kind of new conversion experience that led me to revise my theory of secularization. It had to do with my reading of the evidence. And I look at religion really all over the world. That's my gig. It's impossible to say that we live in a secular age. The empirical evidence just doesn't allow it. We live in a furiously religious age, with some interesting exceptions, which have to be explained. No individual can do this. I don't suffer from delusions of grandeur. But a number of us have decided that we really have a new paradigm on religion and modernity, which focuses on pluralism, which is a pervasive phenomenon. And my own angle on this, I published in a book a little less than a year ago, last fall, called The Many Altars of Modernity, Toward the Paradigm for Religion in a Pluralist Age. I think some copies are on display out there. I have a deep respect for the wit and wisdom of African cultures, and my favorite Zulu proverb is, if I don't beat my drum, who will? Enough by way of introduction here. I also have come to use the term, and that's a big concession, with secularization theory wasn't altogether wrong. I use the term there are two pluralisms. There is pluralism in the usual sense of the word, which is all these different religions coexisting more or less at peace. If they don't, it makes no sense talking about pluralism. If Shiites and Sunnis are killing each other, that's not what anyone means by pluralism, or Protestants and Catholics did during the 30 Years' War. So the pluralism is all these different religions coexisting, which is becoming more and more a feature throughout the world. Since I'm in a Jesuit university, let me mention a few weeks ago, in fact, 2 weeks ago, six Jesuits from Latin America came to see me. They wanted to discuss pluralism in Latin America, which is certainly for Catholics a very new idea. One of these countries were considered to be Catholic countries, and well, they are not anymore monolithically Catholic, and that's a challenge not just to the Catholic Church, but to the self-understanding of these societies. But then there's the other pluralism, which is between secular discourse, between religious discourses and the secular discourse, which is inevitable in a modern society. It's originally based on science and technology, but it now has much broader implications. And the further implication, which I think is very important, is that I think what this new paradigm allows us to do is to not see religion and modernity in some kind of conflict. Most people who have religious faith of whatever kind do not see religion as necessarily as being an either-or proposition, religion and modernity, but both and. And they manage in different ways and in different levels of sophistication to be both religious and secular. Now, this has to do with religious freedom almost immediately, because religious pluralism has to be politically managed. That's what I call formulas of peace. And the relationship between religion and secularity has to be politically managed. And religious freedom becomes an issue almost immediately once you begin thinking in those terms. Now look, religious pluralism is not a totally new thing. It has existed on and off in different periods of history, in different cases, different countries. And it always required some kind of political arrangement to make it livable. Edward Gibbon, in his History of the Decline of Rome, neatly summed up in a formula how late Roman Empire managed the coexistence of different religions. And I'm quoting Gibbon, a very famous passage. "The people regarded all religions as equally true, the philosophers as equally false, the magistrates as equally useful." Very sophisticated, supercilious relation to religion, which I think would have been written by Confucian. I think it very much describes the classical Confucian scholar who were contemptuous of things like Buddhism and popular religion. They knew better. One could call this pluralism tolerance by contempt, tolerance of pluralism on the basis of contempt. Let me say in passing that I think the religion policies, at least until now, it may be different, become different under President Xi, of the People's Republic of China is more Confucian at this point than Marxist. Think of Gibbon's formula. I think it's a good way of thinking about China today. So there were a number of different cases throughout history. There was certain periods under the Caliphate of Cordoba in Muslim Spain, what they called the conviviencia, living together in peace between Muslims, Jews, and Christians. There was the Mughal Emperor Akbar in the better years of the Ottoman Empire, where there were some kind of religious pluralism, and then the millet system did provide certain freedoms and certain privileges to non-Muslims who were second-class citizens but could flourish over long periods of time. Now, in Western history, I mentioned this thing before, it was the Peace of Westphalia, 1648, which ended the 30 Years' War and created a formula of peace. The formula of peace was a territorial formula. The ruler, the prince, whatever, king, whatever he was, would determine the religion of the country and of his state. And those who didn't like it could leave. which was better than being killed or forcibly converted. This territorial formula works fairly well as long as there's some kind of geographical division between faiths in any case. If they're all over each other, it doesn't work. For example, it has been suggested in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, but it's very difficult. They're all over each other in a small territory. So I think this is not a very hopeful a combination of religious freedom in whatever measure and the state. And that is why, for practical reasons, one should put one's money, no matter one believes in religious freedom as a good in itself, which I do, one should put one's money on some kind of separation of the state and religion. Not necessarily in the formula of the U.S. Constitution, but something at least like it, where the state is not totally identified with a single religion, though there are interesting in-between cases, the United Kingdom being a very interesting one. I like to talk about the United Kingdom because the one of the topics here is U.S. foreign policy, and the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom has this wonderful phrase, countries of concern. And then they make reports, I think on the whole, very carefully about countries where one has reason to be concerned about religious freedom. And I think they're being careful to talk both about our enemies, like Iran, and our friends, like Saudi Arabia, who crazily resemble each other, I think. Well, my question is, an interesting question is, what does one have to be, what does a country have to be not to be of concern? Russia right now, I think, one has to be concerned about religious freedom in Russia. If you think there's a concern about the United Kingdom, you have to be crazy. There's as much religious freedom in England as there is in any other Western democracy. Although the Queen is still the head of the Church of England, the Archbishop of Canterbury has an important position, the Anglican bishops sit in the House of Lords. Should one be of concern about this? I think not. In a way, it's like a millet system where the Sultan was very, very tolerant of other religions. If the Patriarch of Moscow behaved today as the Archbishop of Canterbury behaves today, I don't think we'd have to be concerned, even if orthodoxy is declared to be an important part of the Russian soul. In other words, whether for practical reasons or for philosophical reasons, I think emphasizing religious freedom is a very practical way of approaching the issue of pluralism. And in my opinion, it's the most effective ones. Though, let me say again, it doesn't have to be a translation of the First Amendment into Russian or Chinese or Bulgarian. There are different types of separation between religion and the state, some de jure, some de facto. Even in Western democracies, there are significant differences, and I'm sure this will come out in the next 2 days. Religious pluralism means that individuals are constantly confronted with others whose faith is different. Hare Krishnas chant and dance in front of medieval cathedrals in Europe. Protestant missionaries from South Korea sneak into India or China with Bibles hidden in their suitcases. Conversations with neighbors and colleagues of other faiths are commonplace in America. And this leads to something I call cognitive contamination. If you talk to people in a friendly way long enough, you begin to be influenced by them. And that's true in religion as in anything else. And that undermines something that has been true of religion through most of human history, the taken for grantedness of a particular religious tradition. I read somewhere, I'm not a classical scholar, that when two strangers met in ancient Greece, and they want to know where they came from, they would say, "What gods do you worship?" And that was like if we would ask today, "What's your zip code or your area code?" Depending where you came from, you worshiped certain gods. It was taken for granted. There were some rebels like Socrates in Athens, but basically, if you were Athenian, you worshiped Pallas Athene. That is no longer possible. And the loss of taking for grantedness is, I think, a fundamental consequence of pluralism, and I think not one to be deplored for Christians, if only for the simple reason that our situation is very similar to that of the late Roman Empire, where Christianity could not be taken for granted because it was totally new. And when Paul preached in Athens, mentioned the many altars that he saw in Athens, he couldn't appeal to a tradition because what he was preaching was totally new. Very interesting, and that becoming very difficult. Now, one has to emphasize, I would define in this context, fundamentalism is the attempt to stop that cognitive contamination and to restore religion to a taken for granted status in the state and in people's consciousness. That's very difficult to do. That's good news, it's very difficult to do. You either have to set up a totalitarian state which controls all communications, which is also difficult, or to have a sort of mini totalitarianism, a sect where you don't have to physical power to coerce people, but psychological power. Pluralism has then a terribly important, this is on the level of individual consciousness, the loss of taking for grantedness, which is enormously important. And for religious institutions, churches, synagogues, mosques, whatever you want to substitute here, everyone becomes a denomination. Richard Niebuhr defined a denomination as a church which recognizes the right of other churches to exist, in practice if not in theory. Everyone in America becomes a denomination. Even Judaism, which after all used to be the religion of a people, in the old pale Russian, the Jewish pale in Russia, if you lived in a shtetl, you had no choice but to be Jewish. You may not like it. It wasn't a good thing to be Jewish, but there was no escape. In America now, there are four, at least, Jewish denominations. And if you count the different Hasidic schools, you have even more, because each Hasidic school, in a way, is a denomination. Everyone in America becomes a denomination. Why? Because of the historically avant-garde character of the United States as being both pluralistic and having a legally guaranteed religious freedom. Speaking of Jews, the wonderful American Jewish Jacob, this American Jew who is stranded on a desert island, and he builds, he's all by himself, he builds two synagogues, one in which he prays and the other in which he never wants to be seen alive. That's denominationalism. A student of mine discovered 60 schools of Buddhism in the greater Boston area, ranging everything from tantric Buddhism, from Tibet to you name it, Zen, whatever. Now, the US government, as was mentioned before, is obligated by law to monitor and to advocate religious freedom worldwide. Now that Ireland and Poland have been not so slowly sliding toward Eurosecularity, the United States is, by any empirical criterion, the most religious among Western societies. It is also a democracy. It is therefore inevitable that there should be pressure on governments to represent the values, religious and otherwise, of the citizenry within the limits set by the Constitution. It is also inevitable that this should be resented as hubris, both by some of our friends and some of our enemies. I remember some time ago I talked with a Swiss diplomat who was talking about the annual report on religious freedom by the State Department. And he was talking about the other one, the annual report on human rights, which is separate, I believe. And he was very angry. He said, "Who the hell are you to give me a grade of A?" Because Switzerland has about two lines. There are no records of genocide or anything like that. One sovereign country in the world today gives grades from A to F to every other country in the world. That's a remarkable development, which, by the way, creates great difficulties for American diplomats. Other people are more qualified to talk about it than me. Diplomats, after all, are required to discuss the interests of their country with tyrants. Can you interrupt an amicable relationship about, I don't know, import duties on coffee with a little remark, "By the way, you should stop persecuting so-and-so"? It's not very easy. remember it was some years ago, I was in Bulgaria.
He's getting there.
We're getting there. And I talked to a young American diplomat in the embassy in Sofia, and his job was to prepare both reports on religious freedom and human. He hated it. He had to spend enormous amounts of time recording every incident of religious conflict or intolerance in Bulgaria. Well, others can talk about this at greater lengths. When I said, what does a country have to be to not be of concern to the International U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, it raises very interesting philosophical questions, in addition to the practical ones. Is there a minimum of acceptable religious plurality before any outside observers will acknowledge that there indeed exists freedom of religion? What are the minimum requirements before you stop being quote-unquote concerned? This may not be as easy as it first seems. However, given the place of religious rhetoric in American politics, the question, it seems to me, has potentially very interesting implications. Okay, enough said about religious pluralism having to be politically managed. The secular space also has to be politically managed. I think historically the origin of a secular space is science and technology, but it has spread into other areas. Science and technology are not possible except in a secular discourse. There is no such thing as a Lutheran dentistry or a Presbyterian physics. It's either good physics or bad physics. In Boston, I know a very successful Jewish surgeon. He's very, very friendly guy, and his patients love him, and he wears a yarmulke in his practice. And I think he's very observant, and he's very serious about his Judaism, and I think the way he understands his vocation, this comes through in the warmth with his patients, the interest he takes in his patients. He's the prototypical, ideal Jewish doctor. But when he's doing surgery, this becomes, for the moment, totally irrelevant. You can't see if it's a yarmulke because he has one of those caps. And every move he makes has to be in a strictly secular discourse. If he's worried about some move within the operation, he cannot consult the Talmud. If he did, he would be sued, even by Orthodox Jewish patients. Religion and secularity intersect in very interesting ways everywhere, all the time. We had in Boston recently, we organized, I and some colleagues, a conference on the hospital as an interaction between secular space, medical system, and religion. The hospital is based on modern science and technology. There's a strict hierarchy. The physicians, dressed in their long white robes, constituting the clergy, medical specialists on top, as sort of gods, and lesser clerics under their command. Further down, the masses of nurses and technicians, and then the laity, often dressed in demeaning underwear, and waiting and trembling what the hierarchs will what sentence they will pronounce on them. Nevertheless, the hospital in modern democracy, certainly in the United States, is constantly infiltrated by religion. You have chaplains, a wonderful study recently by Brandeis sociologist Wendy Cage, a study of hospital chaplains. Not wonderful title, I recommend it. It's called God Calling. Oh, no, Calling God, excuse me, Calling God over the PA system. I recently met a Buddhist chaplain in Beth Israel Hospital in Boston. Very interesting. But then there were informal contacts, clergy coming from the outside, families praying, nurses having Bible study, and so forth. In other words, in an emphatically secular institution, religion constantly comes in. Now, it's not just science and technology. Hugo Grotius, 1583 to 1645 are his years. He was a Dutch jurist who helped shape modern international law. And he proposed that this discipline should be developed as if God did not exist. He wrote in Latin, "Etsi Deus non daretur," as a secular discipline without any theological presuppositions. Grotius had no choice. He wrote in a Europe which was divided between Protestants and Catholics. You had states defined as Lutheran, Anglican, Calvinist. You had the Russian Empire. You had the Ottoman Empire. If international law was to apply to all of them, it could not be in the name of any one single god. And Grotius created, although he himself was a very pious Protestant in the Netherlands, he created the format of a thoroughly secular discourse, which is true of law today in the United States and other modern countries. A judge who has to, federal judge or state judge or whatever, who has to make a judgment, has to operate within the secular context. He cannot suddenly inject his Baptist faith or whatever other religion he has into his decision. It's not allowed. So secular space is very important. And obviously, Americans are the most litigation-prone people on earth, and you have constant, the courts are constantly occupied with boundary negotiations between the secularity of the law and various religious interests and so forth. Now, to looking around the contemporary world, it is not difficult to find many cases, not just a hospital, where even a robustly supernaturally oriented religion can coexist with the secular space of modernity, secular spaces in the plural of modernity. Unlike so much of mainline Protestantism, the Roman Catholic Church has maintained such robust supernaturalism. And I give you a very robust example. Imagine the Pope in his Popemobile driving through the vast stretches of Vatican State on a mission, let us say, as clearly supernatural as he's proclaiming a new saint, which actually extends the authority of the Pope into the other world. Couldn't be anything less secular than that. Unfortunate accident, the Popemobile doesn't start. Whom do his aides call? I'm sure the Vatican has an exorcism office. It certainly must have a big garage with car mechanics. I think they will call the car mechanics and not the exorcist. It doesn't mean that the Pope doesn't believe in the possibility of exorcism. It's irrelevant for the problem at the moment. This insight can be spinned out in many ways, which I have no time to do. But let me mention one other, I think, important thing, and it also involves religious freedom. Increasingly, countries ask, and this is very much an issue in immigration policy in Europe today, what are the basic values and beliefs that we really insist upon as the foundation of our nation, of our state? I think no country can exist without certain common values, which people accept and live more or less in accordance with them. Otherwise, the country would collapse from within and be completely helpless against aggression from outside. What are the basic German or French or Italian or whatever values that one insists upon that incoming immigrants, wherever they come from, will have to accept? In the United States, we are rather formal about this. People sort of swear an oath of allegiance upon becoming citizens. I remember I did many years ago. Other countries don't have that. And I think in Britain, you just get a letter from the post office. As you know, subject of the Queen. Nevertheless, there is now discussion of British values, as there is English values and Scottish values. What are the values that we really, the core of what we believe in? And this leads to a very interesting implication, and I think I will end with this. Have I gone over my time, Walter?
Peter, you couldn't possibly.
I could, believe me, I could. On this topic, I could talk until midnight, which I will not do. Take the case of Germany, Federal Republic. The Constitution of the called the Fundamental Law, the Grundgesetz of the Federal Republic, was promulgated in 1949. That, I think, was very soon after the establishment of the Federal Republic. Unlike the United States, where the Bill of Rights came some years after the Constitution in a separate document of the amendments, and amendments have been added since then, in the German Constitution, the Bill of Rights comes at the very beginning. It begins with the lapidary sentence, "The dignity of man is inviolate." Die Würde des Menschen ist unantastbar. It's a very powerful statement. Everything else depends on the state preserving the dignity of man. Now, this has a historical context. This was just a few years after the collapse of Nazi Germany, in which the people who made the Constitution were very aware of, with its monstrous violations of human dignity. And just a few miles from where they were sitting was the border of the Soviet Empire, with its own horrors of violation of human dignity. Perhaps not as bad in 1949 as a few years early, but bad enough. No, this is not what we want. This is not our basic values. It's the dignity of man, which is the basic value from which everything comes. Now, what is the religious basis of this? And many of the people in that constitutional assembly were pious Christians. Catholic social doctrine was important at the time. Many were very pious Protestants. At that time, Germany was less Protestant than it is now, with the East. Now Protestants are in a rather robust majority, but whether Catholic or Protestant, the parties that called themselves with a C and still do, were not dogmatic. They were political parties appealing to not just Catholics or Protestants, but to any citizen of the state. And this has a very interesting implication, the dignity of man. Christians and Jews, certainly, would have a religious legitimation for that statement. Why the dignity? Why is that inviolate? Because man is created in the image of God. And if you violate human dignity to the extent that Nazis and communists did, you are spitting in the face of God. But not all Germans were pious Christians at all. Not then, not now. They had other reasons for asserting this basic principle. An understanding of the human condition and the nature of man, which has many Christian roots, biblical roots, but some people who do not accept these roots believe in them very fervently. I know many of them. And what's the interesting possibility? That people may affirm common values with some passion, actually, for different reasons, some of them religious and some of them secular. And this, I think, has a very interesting implication also for religious freedom, that the secular state, secular space, this is the political secular space, can itself become a formula of peace, based on a shared recognition of the quality of being human. I think I'll stop with that.
Well, thank you. Well, that was a real tour d'horizon. Oz, did it inspire any thoughts or responses or questions in your mind?
Thank you. It's a tremendous privilege to be here. I did my doctorate on Peter's work 40 years ago.
I've regretted it ever since.
Followed him then and ever since, so it's an enormous privilege. I'm a great admirer of Walter's writing. I only heard of this. My wife and I were coming to join you in the audience at 7:45 when I heard about David Brooks's misfortunes. And then we spent an hour sitting on a traffic jam on Chain Bridge. So forgive me for being late and speaking off the cuff. My family, as you heard, are Anglo-Irish. So I'm not American. And I would say very simply and straightforwardly, it is time for America to stop squandering her heritage of religious freedom and to do justice to the extraordinary tradition you have. James Madison called the American way the true remedy for religion and public life and diversity. John Kennedy, not far from here, a few months before he died, talked about the challenge of making a world safe for diversity. Clearly, no one has come closer than the American Republic. Not perfectly. Think of the anti-Semitism or the nativism and the Philadelphia riots and things like that. Not perfectly, but maybe the most nearly perfect order in human history, combining such diversity with such liberty and still achieving such harmony. And yet, after 50 years of culture warring, America is squandering her heritage. And I had the privilege of speaking on the issue around the world. I've spoken in China and Russia and many, many places. And again they say, while you recommend America, she's not doing so well herself at the moment. And many of those countries would like to return a reverse report on religious freedom in America, which would be interesting. But some simple points. First, I would underscore Peter's main point of the challenge of pluralization. What it's doing is putting enormous stress on all the traditional settlements of religion and public life. I think when Prince Charles is crowned king, we're going to have a huge debate in Britain, because our settlement is under pressure. The French laïcité is under pressure. Your own system is under pressure. Most of the world's settlements are under pressure, not only from the increase of pluralism, but from things like globalization, travel, immigration, the media, and you can see the internet and social media. All of these are creating this challenge of how we live with our deep differences. Secondly, I think in this country, America needs to reaffirm why religious freedom and freedom of conscience is the first freedom. And you can see that there are many intellectuals who no longer believe that. And you can see elite newspapers putting religious freedom in inverted commas or seeing it as a cover for bigotry. And the proper understanding of it is shamefully distant in many of the elite conversations in many of the universities in this country. And that is a scandal and a tragedy. And the idea that freedom of conscience is the inner forum, which, when protected, guarantees the outer forum of the public square and allows for a free and responsible, robust civil debate. That needs to be anchored back in the American consciousness from the top to the bottom. Secondly, I think its links to civil society and to social harmony need to be stressed again. I would say, thirdly, that we need to face some of the weaknesses that the culture war has shown us in handling this issue, and I just mentioned a couple of them. One, the illiberal liberalism, and two, the unconservative conservatism. You can see that religious liberty today is attacked, and even human dignity is no longer supported, partly because of post-colonial ideas, partly because of postmodern ideas, so that even human rights are seen as fiat rights. And you can see a dangerous severing of the roots of these issues. Peter referred to that at the end. But I think the crisis is far deeper than he was suggesting, and the need for a legitimation of our cultural roots is even stronger. What do I mean by unconservative conservatism? Anyone who loves freedom and the history of freedom, and you can see this in Montesquieu, you can see this in Tocqueville, they pointed out freedom is never guaranteed and protected by law alone. It is guaranteed and protected by law, which is precious and fundamental, but by what Montesquieu calls the spirit of freedom, or his disciple Tocqueville calls the habits of the heart. In other words, civic education. That has collapsed in America in the last 50 years. There are no habits of the heart left in many parts of the country over these issues. And so conservatives are as litigious as liberals. And unwittingly, they're undermining the very stand for freedom that they need to make, both freedom and religious freedom. The heart of what I would argue would be we need to assess models or options or visions for going forward. And as I see it, you really have two extremes in the world today, varieties of a sacred public square where one religion or another is preferred or established. Some mild ones, Peter referred to England, you couldn't have a milder version than the Church of England. some very severe ones, like Iran and Pakistan and Saudi Arabia. But all those versions of a sacred public square do not do justice to pluralism. And even those who'd like to restore, in effect, the 1950s consensus in this country, the religious right, often do not do justice to the pluralism that's increased since then. The other extreme is the naked public square, those who would like to exclude all religion from public life completely. I would just add to what Peter said, we not only have a growing secular space, we have a growing belligerence, if not in numbers, of secularists, and that's different. And I would make a strong difference between secularism, the philosophy, secularization, the increase of the secular space that Peter was talking about, and the third effect, separationism, the deliberate legal attempt to exclude religion from public life. When those three converge, secularism with separationism, and then the notion of secularization or what's left of it in the secular public space, then you have something very fateful that's in the direction of the naked public square, and that's disastrous for many, many reasons. Of course, you have mild versions. You could hardly have a milder one than some of the American visions of that. The French is stronger, the Turkish, Ataturk, stronger still, and the Chinese and North Korean even stronger. But obviously, a naked public square does not do justice to the world's pluralism. What does? I would argue that the fulfillment and development of America's heritage and promise is a civil public square, where everyone of every faith is guaranteed protection of their faith, freedom of conscience, but in the full sense, the right to adopt, to exercise, to share, and to change faith. And obviously the third and fourth of those militate against some of the liberal views of proselytism and some of the Muslim views of conversion. But those are the UN Declaration's understanding of that full right, which is not what the administration called freedom of worship. If that is guaranteed for all, though, but it has to be followed up by what's often called the three R's. Civic education, teaching what are the rights and responsibilities and respect that each person owes to everyone else. A right for one person is a right for another person and a responsibility for both of them. So a right for a Christian is a right for an atheist, and I would insist, secularist worldviews are a religion too. They're an ultimate belief, and I think the European formulation, freedom of conscience, thought, religion, and belief is clearer because it includes secularist philosophies, and some of the greatest European atheists, like Jürgen Habermas, willingly admit that. So for secularists to exclude any religion from public life is highly illiberal. Now, that notion of civility is often misunderstood today. It's confused with niceness. It's confused with a sloppy, lowest common denominator ecumenism, as if we've all got a dialogue long enough and we'll all believe the same things. Not at all. Religious freedom is the freedom to be faithful, and it takes seriously that we're living with differences, and there are very distinctive differences that make a huge difference to public life and to social life. And those are the very things that we've got to debate freely and honestly in our public life. In other words, I think, summarizing it, we need a reaffirmation here in America of the fundamental first freedom of conscience and religious freedom. From the administration across to the last person in this country. And the last 50 years of culture warring have been disastrous. Secondly, we need a restoration of civility, so it's taken out of all the misunderstandings and restored to its being a virtue and a duty for citizens in a very diverse society. And thirdly, we need a restoration of civic education. As much regretted Samuel Huntington said, it's relatively easy still to become an American, but increasingly difficult to know what it is to be American because of the general disappearance of civic education in the last 50 years, especially in the public schools. Tocqueville said at the end of his life, a revolution is rather like a novel. The hard part to invent is the ending. I think the American Revolution, not on race, not on women, not on various other things, but on religious freedom, got it nearly almost perfectly right from the beginning. And this country has written incredible chapters in the history of religious freedom for people of all faiths. But the present generation is squandering that heritage, and it is time for leaders today to rise up, insist on something far more true to America's best and far more effective and demonstrative for the whole world, because this is a world problem today. How do we live with our deep differences?
Thank you.
Well, two fascinating presentations. I don't want to take up much of the audience's time because I think you are better able to ask the questions of these speakers that interest you than I am. But I did want to make one observation, which are two observations, one very quick, one slightly more extended. And that is, first, that I really liked Oz's use of the phrase freedom of conscience. I think once you talk to people about freedom, you know, religious liberty or freedom of religion, you actually are rubbing some people the wrong way right from the beginning. But the phrase freedom of conscience really covers what we mean both by religious liberty and also, of course, the right not to be religious, but I think also freedom of conscience implies duty of conscience. That is, that we believe that freedom of conscience is important because we believe that every human being has a duty to inform and then to follow their conscience. And this may be one way of linking the idea of an individual, grounding an individual right also in some sense of civic duty, which struck me as a tension in the remarks of both speakers. The other thing I'd like to do is to provide a possible framing idea for again, some themes that were there in both talks. And that is to think that what we're seeing in the world today is the triumph of two somewhat linked but also somewhat opposed revolutions. One is what I think of as the Abrahamic revolution, and one is a revolution of individualism. That, as Peter notes, in the time of the Roman Empire or much earlier, in a polytheistic world, there can be different truths, different gods. The laws in Athens and the laws in Sparta can be quite different. No one feels troubled by that. It's just the way things are. But once you get this Abrahamic idea that there is one God who made everything, and who is a moral being as well as simply a powerful representation or personification of natural forces, then there is implicitly this concept of a moral order that ought to be universal. And if Athenian laws do not reflect the will of the Creator, there's something wrong with Athens, and it needs to be changed. So, what we've seen over the last few thousand years is the spread of Abrahamic religion from originally the religion of one small group of tribes in the Middle East to become in Christianity and Islam and Judaism today now added over 50% of the world are believers in a religion that is Abrahamic in this sense. And so the idea of a universal moral order has become a much more important factor in world politics, international politics, and in legitimizing the rule of states in different parts of the world. Unfortunately, as we may have noticed, those Abrahamic faiths don't agree on all the details of the divine program that needs to be implemented. And so Abrahamism is, among other things, an engine of conflict. But there is another element that is connected to Abrahamism, which is also present, and that is the individualistic revolution, seeing individuals as being the source of the seat of moral choice, that the state is no, the individual is not thought of simply as an entity that owes duties to the state, but as an entity of transcendent importance as the ground of state law and legitimacy, the individual. And so in individualism is going to increase pluralism. Individuals don't come to the same conclusions. And also a society that reflects the logic of individualism is going to be a permissive society that encourages individual expression, individual invention even of ways of living, while traditional Abrahamic societies have sought to impose a conformity on the choices that individuals make in the name of the order that Abrahamic faith seeks. A couple of quick points here. One is that we ought to see the secularism in the ideological sense, as opposed to the pragmatic sense, as an Abrahamic religion without God. That is to say, there is one source of truth, science, nature, however you focus it. Marx was originally, in a sense, the person who explicitly developed a kind of an Abrahamic world-ordering faith that didn't have God in it, but had all the characteristics of Abrahamic faith, including universalism, even including a vision of apocalyptic struggle at the end of history, which would see the creation of a secular kingdom. The Enlightenment is in this way. The secular Enlightenment is also a form of Abrahamic faith, even if the faith is not in the deity of Abraham. Again, there is a universalistic notion to modern secular thinking. There is a moral sense that we ought to conform ourselves, we ought to be conformed to obey the dictates of reason, that states should be grounded in a way everywhere. There's one truth everywhere. Paris is not so different from Delhi that a fundamentally different way of seeing the world should apply. So when we think about freedom of conscience in an Abrahamic world, we're talking about a tension, an inherent tension between faiths which in their nature seek to build world orders grounded on moral and in some cases religious reflection, but also a value of the individual which proceeds out of Abrahamic ideas about the direct relation of the creation of God, or as the individual personality as the seat of values. So we're trying to both exist in an Abrahamic world and to mediate the quite difficult contrast within Abrahamic thought. And that's true whether we are Christian, Muslim, Jewish, secular, or increasingly none of the above, because one of the ways that Abrahamism is changing the world is that faiths like Hinduism and others have been conforming themselves, becoming more Abrahamic in the way both they organize themselves and understand themselves. So, a few thoughts there, and now I think it would be interesting to open it up to the audience for comments, suggestions, denunciations, whatever you like, but I would remind you all of the story of the young rabbinical student talking to his rabbi and got a little frustrated because every time he would ask the rabbi a question, he never got a straight answer. The rabbi would always answer with a question. He says, "Rabbi, why do you do this? Why don't you just give me the answer? Why do you always ask a question with answer a question with a question?" The rabbi says, "And what's wrong with a question?" So think about that as you respond. What's wrong with a question? Are there any questions? We have people with microphones, I think, who are around to... Do you have somebody? Yep.
Is this on? Yes. This question is for Mr. Guinness. You know, he mentioned...
For you.
Okay, my name is Prem Jain. I'm a professor here in Georgetown. And You can tell probably that I'm originally from India and I've lived there about 30 years in America. And I've been very much interested in religions in different countries, including Buddhism and all that. Mr. Guinness mentioned, quoting Tocqueville and others, that we are squandering the American values, which have been found, the country has been founded on those values. My experience is actually totally different. I mean, I've been here approximately 40 years, and I've lived in the South, I've lived in the Northeast, and so on. And my experiences, maybe recent observations I haven't made fully, is that there's much more religious freedom now than 40 years ago when I came. People are much more open about religions from different countries, and they accept people in their homes and other places much more so. So where do you get this feeling? Maybe you can elaborate on that we are squandering on the values which were founded after Tocqueville and others. Thank you.
I'm not here to argue that America is in bad shape. But I would just say, on the one hand, you've seen an enormous increase of people from all over the world. And the idea that everyone is now everywhere is certainly true. And that has increased enormously a sense of people getting along with other people from different backgrounds. But in terms of the American public, and especially the elite understanding of religious freedom, you just compare, say, the late Clinton years, where something like the Religious Freedom Restoration Act was passed with such an overwhelming consensus, with the current debate this last year about religious freedom. And clearly the misunderstandings are rife. As you were suggesting, Walter, religious freedom without freedom of conscience is dismissed as freedom for the religious, or freedom of worship, and all sorts of other distortions which show a most incredible ignorance of what religious freedom has been at the elite level. But I'm glad for the increase of a tolerant getting along with people because of the increase of people from all over the world. That is certainly true. But at the elite level of justification of it, I think America's gone backwards through the culture wars.
Okay. Yes, we have one here, question? Sarah? Yes.
Fascinating panel, thanks to you all. Walter, a question for you, just to understand better. Abrahamic revolution, then comes the individualistic revolution. But isn't there an individualistic component to Abrahamism, as you pointed out by saying the individual being responsible to God and having that personal morality? And that therefore, can individualism and Abrahamism might not be in conflict, but maybe individualism is an emphasis on one aspect of Abrahamism. And I've actually read that sort of stuff in your books and, you know, have been benefiting from those. That's why I want to help you, I mean, ask you to elucidate that a bit
right.
more. Thank you.
All right. No, thank you. I think, well, I would say that, yes, the importance of the individual does proceed from basically an Abrahamic view that, again, there is one God who created everybody. And because he created everybody, everybody matters. And they matter to God, the source of all being and all meaning. So there is a transcendent importance to what the fate of each individual human being. People are not objects, they are subjects because of God's creation of them. Nevertheless, that's very much in tension as a practical matter with the kind of moral universalism that many Abrahamic faiths enjoin. So, you know, you'll find people saying, well, it's precisely because one person says, well, I'm Abrahamic, and that's why I'm following my own conscience and guide, and I'm going to live an openly gay lifestyle. And then somebody else says, well, I'm an Abrahamist, and that's why I'm going to stone you for doing that. So I think we have to say that there's a tension in these values that doesn't go away. We do have to, I think, ultimately recognize them each of them as a fundamental value. And this is one of the reasons I think freedom of conscience, which in many ways was the key to, say, what the Second Vatican Council did, is it reformulated ideas of religious liberty, that it is liberty of conscience that may be the key issue here.
Could I add something to that, Walter? My Jewish friends, Lord Sachs, for example, Rabbi Sachs, argues that Judaism is a great combination of universalism and particularism, that they don't conceive themselves as being Judaists for the world. They're Judaists for Jews. Now, I think our Christian balance of that, as you suggest, is freedom of conscience. So when Tertullian is the first one to talk about freedom of conscience, it's
How do we move other societies, other faith communities that are trying to protect their own faith communities in that direction?
Look, I mean, I've had been quite a few discussions with Muslims in recent years, and I cannot tell Muslims what they should believe, but in the context of anti-jihadism or rejecting the kind of persecution of Christians or other minorities that you referred to, I always begin with the sentence, with the fact that every single chapter of the Quran begins with a formula, in the name of God, who's compassionate, who's merciful. That is, before anything else is said in the Quran, comes that statement in Arabic, Bismillah al-Rahman al-Rahim. What does that mean? What is this at the core of your faith, or is this accidental at every chapter of the Quran? Begin with that. And there are ways of getting to tolerance and acceptance of other faiths in these methods. I think it's possible in Buddhism. It's possible in Islam. It wouldn't be the same reasoning as a Christian or a Jew would have. But these different reasons may lead to a strong affirmation of the same basic values as in the German Constitution. That'd be my response to that.
Okay. Any closing thoughts, Peter?
Yes, one closing thought, I wrote this book, which if you are praiseworthy enough to read it, tells you absolutely nothing about my religious beliefs. It's an exercise in pure Weberian social science, value-free and objective, which I strongly believe in. But I'm not completely value-free. And I am, as I said before, I'm a Christian of a rather heterodox, mildly Lutheran form. And I wrote now an essay, which will be published, a Christian postscript to what my book, The Altars of Modernity. And there are the basic messages to Christians or any other religious believers: don't be afraid of pluralism. It's good for you. And it's good for you for three reasons. And I only mentioned the third, which I think is the most interesting. Pluralism, because of the phenomenon of cognitive contamination, which I referred to in my earlier remarks, forces you to distinguish between the core of your faith and things that are more marginal, which are negotiable, which you can surrender to this contamination. Rabbi Hillel the Elder, one of the founders of rabbinical Judaism, Jewish law, was once asked, I think mockingly, could you explain the meaning of Torah while you stand on one leg? And he did. I don't know if he chose the right formula. He chose the formulation of the Golden Rule. His version, I think, don't do unto others what you'd hate if it's done to you. I'm not sure that that's the core of Torah. I would have chosen the Shema, the basic Jewish confession of faith. The Lord is our God and the Lord is one, which antecedes all the moral teaching. But I think that is a very useful exercise. And when modern biblical scholarship invaded theological faculties in first in Germany, well, in Europe, and also in the United States, Christians were forced to ask that question. If not every sentence in the Bible is inerrant and is scientific fact, what then can we do away with? And that question was extremely useful. And when you keep asking that question, certain things become take on a different form. What is what I really, if you push me against the wall, if you wake me up at 2:00 in the morning, what do I really believe? And that's a very useful thing, and that's the consequence of pluralism. And it doesn't make for relativism or for anything goes. It's a
reflection on what is essential.
Us, closing thoughts?
Let me respond to the earlier question. I like the two phrases together, freedom of conscience or religious freedom, and unite them. Because freedom of conscience by itself can be misunderstood as purely internal, just as freedom of worship by itself can be made purely internal. Whereas I think if we look at the UN Declaration, you have four very tough rights: the right to adopt, the right to practice, the right to share. And that's against liberal notions of the unthinkability of proselytism, and the right to convert. And that's against the Muslim notions of blasphemy and conversion. So I think the full thing is a very tough-minded thing. But if we unpack it, then the challenge is, how on earth do we do it with so many people of different faiths all in one country? And that's where I think we need to have a lot more talking together of how we live with these deep differences, and it will not be resolved by law alone. And so America should be in the business of saying, look, we're more diverse than ever. How can we take this brilliant notion of freedom, which has been so incredible, and expand it in our time and still achieve justice and diversity and social harmony? So that's the challenge. I think your question was fascinating. We didn't have time for that. The epistemology of thought, conscience, and freedom. But sadly, we don't have time for that one. I think it's very interesting.
All right. Well, thank everyone for participating in the forum. Peter Oz, as usual, it was brilliant. And I know you have a great program planned for the rest of the day. So I think we've got a coffee break now.